This is also subject to exempting, so we may well have some discussion about this there. Mostly for noting the three updates, including the Mayor's approval of the rail freight facility. And there is one decision tonight, and that's to agree the funding development agreement set out in paragraph 1.8 and onwards as well. But are there any questions on this report, Councillor McGurk, Councillor Cook?
Obviously, I raised the issue right across the bookables at Policy Resources on Monday. This is a massive, massive project. And my concern is that because it's got applicants of PNR and R, and there's a sort of housing element to it, that we make this a trip. I would like to see some sort of independent working group that brings in, because it's not just about, obviously, housing is the political football that may well be become for all these reasons. But there are other issues, as I said before, early in the meeting, other infrastructure issues, around health, education, transport, green spaces, environment. I just think it's an opportunity to miss if we don't actually have bringing the skills, not just P&R and R, to actually deal with this particular item. I also have concerns, I mentioned before, that delegating authority, we want a committee structure. It should be committees and councillors that make decisions, not necessarily delegated with chairs of committees and officers, especially something this big. If we want to make it work, I think the council should own this project, and that's all 63 of us need to have some input and ownership of it. It is a massive project. I've put you on the table, apart from Councillor Cook, who's been in and out for some time, one of the longest serving councillors. And I remember, according to when I used to first start it, Critical Brain Cross, we were probably on the agenda even then. So it's been around for a long, long time. I don't want to make mistakes when other generation projects have. I just think I think we should set up a separate committee that brings in people from all different committees. Because it isn't just about housing, it isn't just about train station, it isn't just about Brain Cross. It's got far more wider reaching social impact and also working with the neighbouring authorities that we've got, even Harrow to a certain extent, but definitely in Camden. I think if we get it right now, we can have a fantastic project. If we get it wrong, in 4 years' time, something has to take it.
I think on some levels that does already exist. I mean, there is a stakeholder group that consists of myself, the leader of the opposition, I believe now Rock Councillor Houston as well, which looks across all the issues. And indeed, these reports do, it's not just these issues keep going back to us, actually. The Brent Cross update brings everything involved, the Brent Cross, to this committee. It'll be only sometimes three or four things need to be updated, but it does cover, it's quite wide ranging, these updates. It's not just repeating the same things. So I think you're asking for some sort of oversight committee. I'm not sure that's necessary, but let's see what other councillors say. Councillor Rosenberg.
When I was substituting for Chairman, on Monday at PNR, seems like a long time ago.
I don't
know. Councillor McGurk made the same point, which, were it not for the existence of this committee, I would consider to be an excellent one. I welcome her to this committee. She's going to bring an enormous amount of depth and breadth to our understanding of Brent Cross, and this is the Brent Cross Committee which you're looking for, Councillor McGurk. I have to say that. There is no reason why we should not bring in issues to do with adults, to do with schools, to do with libraries, to do with welfare. When we discuss Brent Cross at this committee, and we should be abreast of those sorts of issues as much as we should be on top of the development aspects of them. And this is the working committee for doing that in that wide public forum. And of course, it's always possible to refer things up to full council, but I think in terms of, as a deliberative body, this is much superior. So, you know, I say in an entire positive response to that, we will do that, and you know, we will welcome to bring every aspect of what we know to our deliberations and continue to do that.
I mean, we do periodically as well have all member briefings on Red Cross. Sometimes they're well attended, sometimes they're not, but we do attempt to engage with all councillors on this. Indeed, in the briefing just before this committee, there was a training session for councillors where we did talk about Brent Cross in depth. And members of housing and are invited to that, and all other members So shall we just see how we get on with this? And I echo Councillor Rosenberg's invitation to all councillors to take an interest in Brent Cross, and they're welcome to this committee to address this committee, and of course go through the lead members to raise any other issues. And I think through the regeneration strategy, we are very much looking to, by the sounds of it, widen what regeneration does and how we do it and what it means. So you made a point, Councillor McGurk, about delegation. I do think we do need to be light on our feet with some of these things, and we can't just be calling committees all the time to make decisions. It's worked perfectly well for the last, I think, 4 years, and it works well with the cabinet system. Most members of this council, but this committee disagree.
That's what the cabinet system allowed, the committee system
is
very different.
Well, it is different, but my point is, in terms of a small number of members making decisions, we are the art committee. We do make the overall, we set the parameters, and of course, we then need officers in conjunction with some member inputs and then go and implement those decisions. I think we keep calling committees something like this, it just paralyzes us. So I'm content with how things are. If you want to put it to you're welcome, but I'm not sensing yet the support of the committee on that. I'm not sensing any other further point, Councillor Houston.
I've got a couple of questions.
Yeah, of course.
I think getting the transport infrastructure right is critical. I understand that the Bobcat Rail issue and the kind of concerns about that, and also the funding of it, because we have to deliver funding at our end, and we know that the council has got a more challenging financial situation. So I just think this is, I don't know if it's a contentious point, I think this delivers us, as we all know, this committee, potentially revenue stream, so it's something that we have to make sure that we don't allow the overall financial situation to impact, because actually our long-term financial situation is very much dependent upon the scheme going ahead. So that's just a reassurance about that, because the whole scheme depends on rail for success, both the retail and the residential.
So,
can
you clarify, you said the
Orbital Rail, but... Yeah, there's a station and also the Orbital Rail thing, which is the Orbital Rail has been delayed, and the station is about funding.
So, in terms of the station, it's long been the case that when we've got extensive modelling, including the Summer Business Case, which is in the public domain, and is linked to the PNR, the questions we've talked about, that we are very confident that the scheme over its lifetime comfortably pays for itself, rather than business rates. That the challenge that we're going to come back to PNR with a bit more information about is how we're going to cash flow in the early years. So that's a piece of work that's ongoing at the moment, which we'll bring back to PNR. In terms of the Orbital Rail and the points Mr. Cox made, I'm not quite sure we can do it in as real time as Councillor Cook suggests. I do have the sketch, but I don't know that I can quite share it with you unprepared, because just the logistics will convince us. But I do think I'm very happy to sit down with Mr. Cox and with members and talk you through the reasons why we are not anxious in the ways that Mr. Cox did a very, very helpful thing in drawing to our attention that it was important that these two sets of platforms worked as well together as they could do. We think there are deliverable ways in which that can be done, not only in terms of having limited access and step-free access, which of course all modern stations would have anyway, but also in relation to the distances. We believe there is a way of making sure that the stations overlap, and so that you can descend directly from the bridge that accesses the main platforms, also as well as the north platforms if they happen. There are sketch diagrams at the moment. There's a huge amount of due diligence and technical assurance to go through, but at the moment we don't really have a problem. And obviously, officers don't comment on the public questions, but Mr. Cox, if you want to let me know details of the FOI request, I'm concerned that our systems clearly haven't worked in that case, so I will look into that for you. In terms of the number of something we saw more widely, and it's the funding package is still being worked up, that's an ongoing piece of work. If the boroughs make a contribution, it would only be through the sill that is unlocked by housing developments that wouldn't otherwise be possible without the Orbital Railway. So it would be, again, a kind of closed loop, there's not actually an opportunity for us to handle them and come forward with that arrival, so you might have been used both its financial benefits to pay for the arrival. So that's still very much working for us.
Absolutely. So I sort of understand that, that there's an offer to make available sketch maps and meeting to clarify things with Mr. Cooks, who has done a lot of work and raised a number of issues over the years. We're working with this, and we should pay tribute to him for the scrutiny that he has given. Can I just make sure that not only it officers view that the London Overground type trains of maybe four carriages could be accommodated appropriately, but also is it future proof against the possibility of a through service from the Dudding Hillland line to the London Midland main line for longer distance trains, which will be longer, and do we have a design which could accommodate that possibility?
We don't have a design that would accommodate that possibility. I believe there are a number of technical challenges along the length of the line relating to eight carriage trains. Mr. Cox has certainly been very diligent at holding us to account to make sure that we solve those issues wherever we can, and at the moment we haven't got a design that comes up.
Councillor Wardle.
You've spoken a lot in this committee already about lessons learned from regeneration. What I would be quite keen to know more about is the consultation and engagement efforts with residents on the Whitefield estate. How, in practice, how aware are they of the CPO process? How aware are they of, you know, potential implications of phasing? Are they actually as well informed as they should be going throughout this process? Can you hear more about?
So there is a Whitefield State Residents Steering Group that meets regularly. The situation is slightly complicated in that Hampson and Aberdeen Standard are responsible for the rehousing of some of the Whitefield residents, and our Linked joint venture with us are responsible for rehousing some of the others. And they have, over time, sometimes taken slightly different approaches to resident engagement, which is caused neighbours to have a different experience, which has caused sort of anxiety, understandably. I think they are getting a little bit more joined up now, and there is a residence, there's a document that sort of sets out what residents can expect. We do hear as we have open meetings and things, and I've certainly, you know, sat and talked to residents in Whitefield School and with their questions. Are they as aware as we would like them to be? Some absolutely are. Some of all the things going on in their lives, and then, you know, the Red Cross scheme is at the top of their list. But as we move closer and closer to this having real practical day-to-day impact, we will step up the engagement.
It's actually moving on from that point, and what I also what Councillor Dinkins said, historically the Red Cross, especially on the finishing on the green side, they're very isolated. You've got the wonderful estate, you've got red terrace, you've got prayer and walkout, you've got the Welland cottages. And I think in the past, you talk about joint thinking, is that sometimes developers try to play off each community against each other. And I think it's our role to ensure that does not happen. I've seen the developers say to one group of residents of Red Terrace, for example, and not only that, the other end, is always a big, big thing. I think our role here is to ensure that there is, like you said, there's a joined up consultation, and that the residents aren't playing off against each other, and I think it's a real concern, and that's historical. I think it's our role to actually ensure that does not happen.
Councillor Rosenberg, then Councillor Houston, and finally Councillor Simon.
I think that's absolutely right. And I think that we will be there on the ground, and we will be there on the ground on an ongoing basis, pulling together all of this, because behind the scenes there are lots of different organisations, and yes, they may, you know, be commercial partners, and they may have slightly different commercial goals to one another, and it is our job to make sure that we're there for the residents, and I'm confident that we'll be doing that. I just wanted to say, there may be some councillors who remember a time when we weren't regenerating Brent Cross, but there aren't very many. Certainly, it's been a feature of the future of this borough for as long as most of us can recall. And it is just so exciting, I say, touch wood, but to see January 2019 start for Brent Cross London, early 2019 start to works for Brent Cross South, December 18 works to be started for Brent Cross West Tensing. To be actually seeing construction start within the next 12 months, it seems a little unreal in the context of the kind of theoretical discussion we've had. And it is a testament, as you know, as most people here will really readily appreciate, to an extraordinary amount of very, very sophisticated work in putting together an enormous amount of the organisation, 18 years, decades. So as this starts to come to fruition, I think we should all be very impressed with what we've achieved.
Absolutely. And councillor, who's the next councillor? Yeah, I think it's following up the points that have been made, but I think that's true. But this is going to get difficult because it's actually when the bulldozers go in that people don't realise it's happening. And actually, when things go wrong. And so that when quite councillor Waterway and councillor McGovern, you know, we need to get the know that this is happening as a committee, and the committee is, you know, what their thoughts on it are. And actually, I'm not really sure that the mechanisms where those consultations are fed back to us. I mean, you know, there are reports, but actually, do we really get, you know, go down there and see it yourself? But there is an awful lot of evidence that will do that. But actually, you know, I would like us to think about how we report that, the concerns, and the won't be concerns. Things will inevitably go wrong, even in the best run schemes, things will go wrong. And we've had examples of better run schemes and not so well run schemes. And rather than have a situation where it's only with a street protest that we end up engaging with this, we need to start, you know, having a committee our hands, you know, on what's happening locally and what the concerns are, and actually a mechanism for doing that. And I think we just need to think about what the most effective way of doing that is.
Well, we've got a lot of new councillors. And the best thing to do is to have when the next when we reach a milestone, I don't believe happens for the sake of it, but when we reach a milestone or about to that we have another board member meeting, which we've had in the past, and we can feed into that, so we have an aspect on resident feedback, resident engagement. This is the last officers now, but that's what we expect for the next one. And we'll want some feedback from residents, not just this is the engagement, but actually get a sense of what our residents are feeling about it and how they're thinking and what their things are. So you can build on that. Councillor Zinkin.
Yes, I mean, I think what I'd like to say is that many of the residents you're talking about are in my ward. Many of the residents are in Golders Green ward, and many of the residents are in West Hendon. I can assure you that, never mind Brent Cross, but the consequences of Brent Cross as they affect the residents. And your member as well, are actively, daily, hourly engaged with the residents in the ward to ensure that they are both fully informed and as far as possible protected from the consequences of the development. I mean, just as an example of this, in the context of the aggregates depot, we sponsored with the systems of officers a series of meetings which actually ended up in having something like maybe 12 hours of meetings between the residents of the railway cottages that you referred to and DB Cargo, so that they almost negotiated the amendments to the planning conditions, so that in the event that the mayor did give approval, which he has now done, that the planning conditions that were included were ones which the residents were reasonably satisfied would actually provide them a measure of protection. And as a result, it was made sense to certain planning conditions. But that was because the ward councillors collectively engaged with the residents and the developers and the officers to ensure that that was the case.
No disrespect, but railway cottages are the residents who were engaged, even in Whitehall, the State and Kids House, which is not your ward, have not been engaged by the ward councillors.
Correct. In helping the right towards a state.
Carry on, Councillor Zinkin. So I think
what I'm saying is that there are all sorts of things going on, which Brent Cross is not only, but speaking for my ward, and I'm sure speaking for West Hendon as well, the councillors plan to be fully engaged with the residents as is required.
Councillor Houston, and I think this should probably be the last.
I'm not saying that I'm and how we get the feedback as a committee. I'm sure individual councillors do their own, you know, we all know that there are councillors who are better than other councillors. And Mark's going to be a very expert at doing that, and Sean's done well, and working with you on that. But actually, as a committee, I think we need to know that this is happening and find out how well it's happening. And we want this to be successful for us, so it's just making sure that kind of feedback is in there.
I think we've made that point quite frequently, and as I say, the next member's briefing, we've got just the all groups of residents in all the different bits of the scheme. We have a thorough report on how they've been engaged. And if necessary, because of course there's different phases and different schemes, and you know, at some point we'll just need to speak to one group and others have separate groups. Okay, can we come to the recommendations? There are four. Can we those in favour of the four recommendations please show? Okay. And those against? Abstentions? Okay, so it's four abstentions. The recommendations are carried. Thank you. That is subject to an exempt paper, which we'll take very, very shortly. Moving on to item 11, the forward work program.